Good morning, students. I am Ms. Moushumi Sengupta, your biology teacher. Today I'll start with the first chapter, that's transport of food and minerals in plants. So now, transport of food means, what is the food made by green plants? It is glucose. Where is the food made in green plants? It is made in the leaf. And how it is made? By the process called photosynthesis. Now, so we will deal with transport of food in plants as well as transport of minerals in plants. What do you mean by minerals? Minerals means the nitrates and phosphates which the plants take in from the soil. So now let us come to the first topic, that is absorption of water by plants. So absorption of water by plants takes place through roots. Now first define root. Root is non-green underground part of the plant. What is the function of root? It helps in the absorption of water from the soil. Now there are two types of root system. One is tap root system. Another one is fibrous root system. So now what is the difference between tap and fibrous root? Tap root has, in tap root, primary root is present. In fibrous root, primary root is absent. In tap root, or tap root penetrates deep into soil, whereas fibrous roots do not penetrate deep into the soil. In taproot is mainly found in dicots, and we see fibrous root in monocots. Now coming to the structure of taproot. Now taproot, when if we see morphologically means the outside structure, then we see that taproot has a primary root. From primary root, secondary roots come out. From secondary roots, tertiary roots or root hairs come out. Now let us come to the next topic, that is movement of molecules. Now movement of molecules in plants. So what are the types of movements we see? One is diffusion. So first of all, what is diffusion? It is the movement of molecules of gases, liquids or solids from the region of higher concentration to that of lower concentration. Now, what is the role of diffusion in plants? First of all, exchange of gases, that is carbon dioxide and oxygen, occur due to diffusion between interior of plant cells and outside air. During photosynthesis, when carbon dioxide is taken in, during respiration, when oxygen is taken in, it is done through this process of diffusion. And exchange of gases between cells also take place by diffusion. So you have to know what is diffusion and role of diffusion. Second type of movement is osmosis. Now, what is osmosis? It is a special form of diffusion which involves the movement of solvent molecules from the region of higher concentration to the region of lower concentration through a selectively permeable membrane. So, what you have to know in osmosis is it's only movement of solvent molecules or water molecules, and also a selectively permeable membrane is necessary. So now what is the role of osmosis in plants? Absorption of water from soil by roots takes place by osmosis. That is through by what is the role of osmosis? Absorption of water from soil by roots is done by osmosis. Okay, now next let us come to the few terms are given over here, like freely permeable, selectively permeable. So you should know the definitions, By the way, selectively permeable membrane is a membrane which allows solvent molecules to pass through it, but it will not allow solute molecules to pass through it. Next, what is root pressure? The pressure developed in the root. How the pressure is developed? Because of continuous inflow of water from the soil into roots, a pressure is developed which is called as root pressure, and it helps in pushing the sap upwards. We'll come to this sap, what is cell sap and all afterwards. Okay, let us move to the next type of movement, that is active transport. So what is active transport? Whenever the substances move from region of lower concentration to that of higher concentration, they use energy in the form of ATP. This process is called active transport. Okay, now that is, here you have to know that the movement of substances takes place from a region of lower concentration to region of higher concentration. So always when it is against the gradient, energy is needed, and that energy is in the form of ATP, that is adenosine triphosphate. Okay, now what is the role of active transport in plants? That is, root hairs, they absorb minerals from soil by the process of active transport. So three types of movements you have learned. One is diffusion. What is the role of diffusion in plants? Second is, what is active transport? That is, its role in plants. And also you have learned osmosis. What is osmosis and its role in plants? Let us move to the next topic, that is conduction of sap. Now, first of all, what is sap? Inside the cell, vacuole is present. That vacuole which is present inside the cell has a liquid in it which is called as cell sap. Now, what that liquid contains? It contains sugar and minerals. So you can say cell sap is a dilute solution of minerals. Now, next let us move to this one, that is, what is conduction or ascent of sap? The upward movement of water or sap from roots towards top of plant is called conduction or ascent of sap. Now, there are some forces which help in ascent of sap. One is capillary force. Next is root pressure. Third is transpiration pull. That means these forces, they help in ascent of sap or conduction of sap. So now, what is capillary force? Now, the xylem tissues, they act like capillary tubes through which water rises up by capillary action. Next is the root pressure. As I said, what is root pressure? The pressure developed in the root due to continuous inflow of water from the soil. So that pressure also helps to conduct sap from roots to the top of the plant. Now next is transpiration pull. What is transpiration pull? Loss of water from the leaves develop a force which pulls water from the root to the top of the plant. So that is called as transpiration pull. So these three forces help in conduction of sap. Next, what is turgor pressure? Now, when water is absorbed by a plant cell, it becomes swollen, or we call that cell as a turgid cell. Now, when the cell is turgid, that time what happens? A pressure is exerted by the cell contents or the protoplasm on cell wall. That pressure is called as turgor pressure. So you can define turgor pressure as pressure exerted by the cell contents or protoplasm on cell wall. Now, due to this turgor pressure only, what's its function? You must know the function of it. It keeps leaves, flowers, fruits expand of the plant expanded. Now, if there is decrease in turgor pressure, then wilting occurs. So, what is wilting? You must know the definition. It means loss of turgidity in plants due to decreased turgor pressure. That means if rate of absorption of water is less and rate of transpiration is more, then wilting occurs. Next topic is importance of water to the plant. At least 5 importance of water to the plant you should know. So water as such, you all know that is required by the plant for the process of photosynthesis. Next, plants absorb minerals and gases dissolved in water. That is, if plants have to absorb minerals, that also, for that also they need water. Next is, water helps in transportation of substances from one region to another in the plant, because in solid form substances cannot be transported, so it has to be dissolved in water. Next, water provides turgidity to plant cell, and water cools the plant. So at least 5 importance of water to the plant you should know. Now some terms related to osmosis. First, what is endosmosis? Inflow of water molecules from an external dilute solution into a cell. Like for example, if resins are put in water, after few hours you will see that the resins, they become swollen. Why they become swollen? Because the outside water flows into the resin. That is, the inflow of water from an outside solution into the cell is called as endosmosis. That is, outside solution, if it is dilute and the inside solution is concentrated, then water will flow from dilute solution, that is outside, to into the cell. So that is called as endosmosis, that is inflow of water molecules from an external dilute solution into a cell. Now what is exosmosis? Like for example, if we keep potato in salt solution, we see after some time that potato shrinks. Why this happens? It is due to exosmosis. What is exosmosis? Withdrawal of water from a cell into an external concentrated solution. That means if potato is kept in salt solution, that means external solution is concentrated and inside potato it is dilute. So water from potato will move out. So that process is called as exosmosis. Now, when exosmosis occurs, what happens? Shrinkage of protoplasm takes place. So, shrinkage of protoplasm of a cell from its cell wall due to loss of water by exosmosis is called plasmolysis. Now, if this cell, which is already plasmolyzed, is put again in dilute water, what will happen? Again, the cell will swell up. So, swelling of a plasmolyzed protoplasm to regain its original volume when placed in pure water, this process is called as deplasmolysis. We have to learn the definitions of these terms. Next, what is transpiration? Okay, what is transpiration? The loss of water vapor from aerial parts of plant is called transpiration. Next is, what is transpiration stream? Now, water travels from roots to the leaves via the xylem vessels, and this flow of water is called transpiration stream. Next, coming to the factors affecting rate of transpiration. What are the factors? One by one, we'll come to it. First is sunlight. If sunlight is there, that means during daylight, what happens? Stomata is open. So, transpiration is more, and during night time stomata is closed, so transpiration is reduced. Second factor is temperature. If temperature is more, the rate of transpiration is more. If temperature is less, then rate of transpiration also slows down. Next is humidity. If the air is humid, then transpiration is slow or less. Next factor is air movements. Air movements, that means if the air is still, transpiration is less. If the air is moving, then transpiration is more. Next, now coming to the next topic, that is potometer. What is potometer? It is an apparatus to measure the rate of water loss from a shoot under natural or artificial conditions. Actually, it is a apparatus to measure the rate of transpiration. Now, there is a table given over here. Actually, this is the setup of the experiment. A cut twig is there. This is a capillary tube. There is a scale. There is a beaker containing water. And reservoir is there, as well as a bubble is introduced into the capillary tube. Now, when we give certain conditions, like if sunlight is there and the air is still, we see the bubble moving to 5 of this meter scale. Okay, that means the what we can explain it, we can say that the rate of transpiration is normal. If the if we give light, sunlight is there and fast current of air is there, then the bubble we see in the 7 of the meter scale, showing that the rate of transpiration is fast. Whereas if it is dark and air is still, then the bubble is at 1, showing that the stomata are closed and no transpiration occurs. Now, next is significance of transpiration. That means, what are the advantages of transpiration? Now, first of all is cooling effect. That is, if because of transpiration, the leaf is cool, or we can say that the plant remains turgid. Next is conduction of minerals. That is, conduction of minerals also occurs due to transpiration. Ascent of sap is also a significance of transpiration. This ascent of sap occurs due to transpiration. And excess water, that is, if excess water is absorbed by the roots, that time also, this because of transpiration, what happens, that extra water is removed. So that if always water is absorbed, then the cell sap will get diluted. So that will, then that should not occur. So because of transpiration, what happens, the excess water is also removed. Apart from the, this, that is, these are the advantages, but transpiration has some disadvantages also. That is, due to transpiration, what happens, lot of energy is wasted in absorbing and lifting the extra water, which is lost through transpiration. First disadvantage. Second, it causes wilting and shedding of leaves. Third disadvantage, that amount of water which is lost by transpiration, that actually is needed for growth of seeds and fruits. So, because of transpiration, what happens? Amount of water available, it reduces the amount of water available, which further limits the growth of seeds and fruits. So, we can say that transpiration has more disadvantages than advantages, but plants cannot check it, and therefore it is called as a necessary evil to the plants. So, remaining part of the chapter next day we'll do.